Contestants, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the senior men training, that will be the soft group.
So just a few minutes away now from the final race of the afternoon, the men's senior race, due to go off in 4 minutes or so. Very strong Ethiopian team. Some famous names in there, Edris and Jaylan, but it could well be Molla who will lead their challenge. Not one of their big names, certainly not on the track, but they're hoping he'll go well. Cheptegei, big support, including of course Stephen Kiprotich there for Uganda, and Cheptegei hoping to go well. Kiprotich will hope to join him. Turretich, they've got a lot of experience in that Ugandan team.
Team Uganda on your screen.
No British men, despite the prominence of their British distance running at the moment. All of our big names with other challenges ahead this year. So Kenya with the names you look down that, Jeffrey Kamworo, big question marks over, can he run as well, or is he running as well as we've seen over the last 2 years? Not so much perhaps on the track last year, but he very much the big name in that Kenyan team, but again full of experience. If he's not on top form to defend his title, then there'll be one or two others hoping to pick up the mantle for Kenya. Last minute checks, yep, present sir, yep, yep. So move along. Really important that they line up in the right order. Not.
It is important for the official.
Absolutely. Would you favour an inside draw or a draw on the far side? Doesn't really matter.
It doesn't really matter, but either end as opposed to the middle, unless you're going to go fast.
Well, they're just about ready to go. Wait for the call forward. Here we go. So the men's senior race gets underway with a rather quiet starting pistol there, but away they go. 10 kilometres of a sprint for 200 metres, followed by about 9,700 metres of hard running after that. For some, the sprinting will not cease, to be fair. There's a few people right up there at the beginning. Will not last very long. And just jostling for a little bit of position. And they'll start to settle down. So the senior men, as ever, the highlight of the programme for many. Maybe some bigger names in the women's race, but Jeffrey Kamworo, the defending champion, has gone off with real intent there, right at the front, and just waiting for things to settle down a little bit. Plenty of challenges for him to think about. Is he in good form? Is he going to be able to reproduce the performance from 2 years ago, which carried him through 2015 and 2016. A year ago, almost a year ago to the day, he won that brilliant half marathon world title in Cardiff when he fell at the start. Well, thankfully for him today, that's maybe why he started a little bit quickly there, Paula. He thought, no, that's not going to happen to me again. It was an incredible performance to fall and get up and win that race. But thankfully for him, safely off and safely near the front.
Maybe if he'd had spikes at the start of that race, he might not have slipped in Cardiff. It would have helped him. But he's certainly more comfortable starting there than he was in Cardiff. Although did that shot of adrenaline help him that day, to think a little bit in terms of, it wasn't the most ideal start, but it certainly helped him to get the best out of himself that day and really fired himself up to get back and to really take it to the other guys, including really the way he took it to Mo Farah in Cardiff a year ago today. But it's all starting again now, and he's just got to go out and race and perform something close to that to be even within a chance of figuring up there. He hasn't been in top form, has he, so far this winter. I think were the rumours that he was suffering from a bit of a lung infection after Rio, so he took quite a long break and only got back into training around the end of November, beginning of December time, and has gradually worked his way back up. So he didn't figure really highly in the Kenyan trials and is still building back into the form that he would have liked to have been in for these World Cross Country Championships. Is him on 90% form still good enough, though, to be really competitive here today?
Well, plenty of names to look out for. You've got the likes of Jaylan coming back to some sort of form, the man who won the world title ahead of Mo Farah in 2011 in Daegu on the track over 10,000 metres. You've got the Olympic champion from 2012 representing the home country. Stephen Kiprotich mentioned him on the start line representing Uganda. They'll be hoping for good performance from him and the team here. Add into that, remember Leonard Correa, if you're watching the Edinburgh cross country, what a good performance from him to beat Callum Hawkins in different conditions to that which we're facing today, running for the USA, former Kenyan. All over the place, plenty of really good athletes. Mukhtar Edris, well known for his track exploits. And then the Kenyan team has got the likes of Leonard Coleman, another one coming back into some sort of form. Brilliant road racer 3-4 years ago. And Leonard Barsatan, the former African cross-country champion. He won that title on this course in 2014. He's tucked in there over on the far side of that lead group. So many big names. There are others who'll be fancying their chances in this field as well. Just picking out a few for you there, but we'll let them settle down. Five laps each lap. The four laps of exactly, or just about exactly, how can that be? Just about 2K, and then the last lap a couple of hundred metres short on that because they go into the finish funnel. So less than 10 kilometres of good cross-country running, but not in the sense of it being muddy and challenging in terms of obstacles. There are a few little ups and downs to contend with, but nothing too much really. So you can really get into your running, and those who judge it well will have a good day. Those who don't, well, they may well suffer. Well, the Ugandans will be hoping that they can cheer their men to at least a medal, either individually or in the team race. After winning the junior gold medal, then they'll be hoping for more of the same here. Pace looks pretty, despite the big group, Paula. I mean, they haven't looked as though they've settled down too much yet. So it sort of looks as though they're pushing on at the front a little bit. But look at that, lots of people close up. And some of those are going to pay a little bit further down the line, that's for certain, as they come to complete the first lap.
Some are definitely going to pay for it, but it is a big pack, and it's the biggest pack so far. And you see the danger as they've come through that narrow area to finish the first loop, because that course narrows down very quickly, and there are a lot of cones out on the course which actually mark the way down to the finish when they come around on the final lap. And some of the guys were getting very dangerously close to some of those cones in the way, but there just doesn't seem to have been any fallers. They've negotiated the logs with a little bit more ease than they actually negotiated the cones, and then now it's Rono temporarily at the front, just starting to push on a little bit, but nobody really wanting to pick it up anything from this, because it is already ticking along, very, very fast and not really having much inroads on the pack. The numbers there are still big. We can see is that a little bit of gap back to the first Australian athlete, and that is quite a big bunch in front of him. It's probably Brett Robinson or Patrick Tiernan there. But this big pack here, Rop in the middle of it, Haddis. Still a big spread, a lot of USA vests still in there. I counted three American vests up there, and I think they are hoping that they will figure up there in the team event, and they certainly have a chance, but at the moment there's a lot of teams with a chance in there.
Well, so far in Kampala, the crowds have been fantastic, and they may well have something to cheer here. Cheptegei is already well to the fore, and well, Kampala for some people was a venue a bit too far to go, but for those who have come to contend, then they're certainly in for some tough racing. It's near the equator. How far from the equator is a question. Here's my first quiz question to you.
What, in meters?
No, minutes. See, I knew you didn't do geography. You're in geography. It's 0 degrees. It's 18 minutes from the equator. That's a silly question. That's a silly answer to the silly question. It is very close. About an hour's drive to the equator, and yet the temperature is about 25, 26 degrees. It's warm, but there's enough of a breeze. It's kept the athletes pretty cool. It hasn't been humid, and I think that's the time of year has meant that it's a little bit of altitude, Kampala, isn't it? It's 3,000 feet. Is it quite that high?
Yeah, about 3,000 feet.
So. Oh, that ditch just caused a little bit of an issue there. But, yeah, so I think that just takes the edge off the temperature a little bit. So it hasn't been too bad. But maybe that little bit of altitude we've seen in some of the other races might have been having an effect on some who've gone off a bit too hard and then paid for that a little bit later. Well, you just saw them negotiate the ditch, which has been... isn't really a ditch anymore in the sense that it got filled in. It was too much of a... During the week, people were a little bit worried about the depth of that and the water was in it, etc. So they filled it in. So it's a little bit of an obstacle, but not too much. But that early pace already starting to take its toll, Paul. A big group just a kilometre ago. They were all bunched up and now they're well spread out.
Yeah, big difference in just one lap there in terms of how well they're bunched. We can see the big people that we would big contenders that we would have expected to be up there. Most of them, I think, are up there in that group. And maybe here as well, the fact that the race is shorter than the guys are used to at the World Cross Country is having a little bit of an impact. They can't take that first lap so much to settle in, because they do then only have four more laps to follow on after that. So they need to knuckle down to the serious racing fairly quickly, and they've certainly done that here today. We've still got the contenders like Rob from Bahrain in there, the Kenyans leading at the front, a big Ugandan contingent. There's definitely three Ugandans up there with a fourth one just going over the hill there, so they will be hoping to get individual honours as well as team honours if at all possible. And Kenyans will have been really fired up by that clean sweep, first ever clean sweep of the first six places in a World Cross Country, certainly in a senior women's race, completed by Faith Kipyegon in the senior women's race.
Yeah, remarkable that, wasn't it? It was Algeria was trying to get in there for Ethiopia, and Kipyegon just got a little bit of track pace to hold her off, and I'm not sure she would have been aware of the significance of that, but top six, first time that's ever been done in the senior women, so well done to Kenya in that, and they'll be hoping for more of the same here in this men's senior race. Cheptegei of Uganda in the yellow, but well to the fore. You can see Jaylan is up there as well for Ethiopia. Edris a little bit further back, the smaller figure towards the back of that kind of lead group. Two, three of the Bahrain athletes in there as well. Watch out for Ayalu, who's been going well. He won the Seville cross country. El Goibai was second there, was in the top 10 2 years ago. So Bahrain with Albert Rop as well in that lead group. So still settling down as they approach the closing stages of the second lap already. And I don't know if they're getting nervous, but I'm getting a little bit nervous because our computer results is struggling to give us an update on what happened in lap one. So I'm hoping that it comes to life at the end of lap two. Otherwise, it's going to be difficult for us to keep you updated with how teams are progressing a little bit further down, although we do have our abacus nearby. So Uganda up there with three in that leading group. There's Moller is towards the back of that group, Paul. I mentioned him right at the very beginning, and a lot of talk in the Ethiopian contingent about him. He's become one of those rare animals that's won the Ethiopian track championships as well as cross country. But he's not a big name. He's never really had the chance to show what he can do on this sort of stage. So the fact that he hasn't started so quickly, well, that doesn't all go well for him, does it? He's well back. There's Jaylan, the first of the Ethiopians, just coming into the picture now. And then Moller, there he is, right at the back of that lead group, and already seems to be struggling with this pace.
Yeah, he's just struggling to hold on to the coattails of Mukhtar Edris just in front of him, who didn't run at all well in their trials but was apparently injured, and doesn't look as though there's too much wrong with him there today. So Mukhtar Edris at his best, that's him now just moved up onto the shoulder of Jaylan, and he is very much involved in this race. Moller was struggling to stay in contact with him. Have a look. Yeah, he's just drifted back even further now, and I think that once that gap opens up in this race, he's not going to be able to work his way back. We're not seeing any reckless surging at the front of this race. We're seeing a sustained increase in pace, and if you're not able to go with that, working your way back to it is going to be very, very difficult.
Rob looks comfortable, doesn't he, in the red of Bahrain. And the Bahrain team actually wear two different vests. Some of them are all red and others are more white. That's helpful. Eritrea, Kifle up there, that's a very famous Eritrean name, isn't it? Kifle, and that's the younger brother of Jonas Kifle. And he's got himself well involved. And as Paula was saying there, Edris is already struggling, the Ethiopians. It's just, you know, sometimes we have seen the Kenyans get a little bit carried away in the early stages, but a little bit of a check there coming around the corner, tight 90-degree turn. But given the experience of the people in the race, you have the men's race. Sometimes you can think in the junior race, maybe they're overcooking this, but in the men's race, less likely to happen. Anyone who's forging at the front is obviously thinking, I feel good today and I'm going to go on. And you can't afford to sit off. You just can't give people, you know, that ground and that, because you know, in that group, there's going to be four or five who are just going to keep pushing on.
Yeah, even sitting at the back of the pack in the world cross country is more dangerous, I would say, than it is on the track. I mean, so many times we've seen Mo, for example, sit right at the back of the pack and be able to react to there from surges from the front. That is much more difficult to do in cross country, particularly when it twists as much as this and when there are a few obstacles thrown in as well, because if you don't react, then it's very hard to make up that ground. Even though you can see them, you can clearly see where you're working back to, just to be able to make that ground up once the pace picks up and once those surges are put in, it's very hard. So you need to be able to be very much aware of who's in that pack, who's at the front, and what they're doing at the front.
Well, the Kenyans might be a little worried because there's only three of them in that lead group, and there are four, five Ethiopians well to the fore. Cheptegei for Uganda. We've got Kifle's in there. There's actually two Kifle's, and I may have got them mixed up. That's Aaron Kifle, World Junior, the younger of the two Kifle's in this. He's the silver medalist from the World Junior 10,000 meter championships last year. Still a teenager, still just 19 years of age. And that means he must have beaten Kiplimo, because Kiplimo was third, I think, in that race. And Kiplimo, who's taken the junior title here today from Uganda. So Cheptegei, well, this will certainly get the crowd on their feet, just pushing the pace on as they go over the mound, that little rise and down the other side, just trying to upset the rhythm a little bit, but not really too much. Kamworo is still right up there, and he's answering the first questions, really, isn't he? Because I think immediately we'll be like, oh, is he in shape, is he not? So even for an athlete who's, you know, as good as he is, if you're not in shape, you can't kind of attack in this early stage. So he's obviously feeling that he can go with this, that he's fit enough, confident enough, obviously. And the pace is fast here. You know, you can just tell that lead group, you know, we are about halfway, and that lead group is well strung out. And look at the damage that Cheptegei is doing.
Yeah, and you definitely get the impression, don't you, that these Ugandans have trained hard on this course and been able to put the preparation in there to just take exactly the right tangents as they're going round the bends and up and over the bumps. But Geoffrey Kwamwara is able to respond to it at the moment. There were questions about his shape coming in, but I don't think he would have come to an event as significant to him as the World Cross Country unless he felt he was at least 90% of the way there. So I think is he there 100%? Maybe not yet, but certainly he's there far enough to be able to come here and commit to racing strongly and to racing well at this stage. As Dida of Ethiopia has now moved through into third, and now quickly these gaps are opening up, and Cheptegei is doing damage in this race.
Yeah, and it'll be interesting because, you know, we've seen a couple of other races, others who, when the surges come, have sat off and managed to maybe not come through to win, but certainly come through to finish second or third. And all of a sudden, Cheptegei, the home favourite, is taking the defending champion, Geoffrey Kwamwara, with him. Cheptegei, who did so well in Rio at the 5,000 and the 10,000 metres, made both finals, top 10 in both races. And as Paulo was saying, surely prepared himself for this. But this is a brave effort. I mean, this is hard running at this part of the race. And there's still a long way to go here. Couple of laps, 4 kilometres of running. But he's decided enough is enough. I'm going to try and win this. I'm going to try to take on the great Geoffrey Kwamwara, who's just starting to roll a little bit. Kwamwara looks as though he's working hard here, as the Ugandan flags already being flown. Way too early to start celebrating, guys, but Cheptegei is giving them plenty to cheer about.
Yeah, it's too early to celebrate, but it's never too early to let him know that you're there supporting him and to give him the boost that he will certainly be receiving from this crowd and from running well on home soil and what that can mean to him. We can talk about whether we should have sent the World Cross Country to Uganda. Has that reduced the number of teams going there competing? But for the Ugandans, it's hugely significant. They've always supported the World Cross Country, and they will have really prepared strongly to be able to put on a really, really tough performance and really strong performance here and take home, bring some medals to them that were going to stay in Uganda as a lasting memory of these championships.
Well, he's running really strongly, isn't he? If he can maintain this, he's just going to run away and win it. So that's the question. If he's getting too carried away, I mean, sometimes the support can get the adrenaline going a bit too much, and you can get carried away a little bit too early and use up energy that you need later on. But look at how he gets up that hill there. Kwamwara trying to chase him. Now he's going to have a tough race there. These two have pulled away quickly from the chasers. That might be Rop, I think, that's moved into third place there. And Kenya will be hoping, Kifle is moving up into fifth now. Kenya will be desperately hoping that they can win this team race. If they're not going to win it individually, they definitely will want to win it in terms of the team race ahead of Ethiopia. And can Uganda get on the rostrum as well? Well, I'll apologise, a bit like with the women's junior race, we are getting no, and you've probably noticed on your screen, there is no reports, no what's
data.
The word I'm looking for? Data, that's the word, thank you, Paula. Around the positions from the transponders that the athletes are using, so for whatever reason that's not working here. So, now is that Rop who's moved already ahead of Kwamwara in the background? Cheptegei forging on. This time, Paula, you'll hear the bell, and that in itself will be a massive encouragement to him.
Yeah, we do get a little bit of data then. It's a 7-second gap, or it was a 7-second gap. Back to Kwamwara, we'll see if that's actually accurate or not, but it looked reasonably accurate. What I didn't like was the look over his shoulder that Kwamwara gave, as if to check behind him, as if he was giving up on the chase in front of him and is more worried about the danger that's coming from behind him and holding that off. That means that Cheptegei has gained the first mental victory, the first psychological victory, and turning the screw. He's managed to get that gap far enough that has he broken the invisible thread that was linking Kwamwara to him. Certainly he's getting huge support from the crowd, which is only going to keep firing him on. Maybe it is a little bit too soon, but I don't think so. I think he knows this course. inside out and backwards and knows exactly where his strengths and weaknesses lie on it and where and when to attack. And he's getting a lot of information out there. A lot of it will just be noise and support, but a lot of it will be information too on how big that gap is, and is he going away with each stride or is it being closed down with each strike?
Well, they're getting excited, aren't they? And why not? You know, it's great when the host country can find a winner, can find somebody to cheer. Just think back to 2012 and what that meant for the likes of Mo Farah and Greg Rutherford, Jessica Ennis-Hill, all of the British athletes. When you're in front of this sort of reception, look at those scenes. He's having another look behind, and he really needs to concentrate on himself, I think, because there is a good race going on behind, but Kamworo may well be in danger of being caught himself. So I think there's Kamworo. He's not that far distant, and he's still running pretty strongly. The chasing group actually a bit further back than I thought from Kamworo. So the only danger from Cheptegei is his own ability to keep going at a reasonable pace. As long as he doesn't fall apart here, you know, maybe the last 300-400 meters can be hard work, but that's 11 seconds. 2 kilometers, you can catch that up. But I don't see Kamworo surging here. I don't see him coming. And there's nobody behind Kamworo who I think is close enough. The closest challenge is a good 30 seconds behind Cheptegei. So, as he comes down to hear the bell, to take the last lap, Uganda have got the man in the front, the man leading. And the crowd going absolutely crazy here. Why not?
If you can even hear the bell over the noise of that crowd, but certainly he looks strong. I don't think he looks as though he's overcooked this too soon. He looks very strong in the way that he's just leaning into those corners. Hasn't even made his final effort yet. Maybe he's keeping that in reserve just in case Kamworo can work back to him. Certainly he doesn't want to underestimate the caliber of Geoffrey Kamworo and what he can come back with over this last lap, but the gap back for me is grown still bigger than 11 seconds, and I don't see Kamworo being able to close that down. Indeed, he might be fully focused on trying to hold on to that silver medal position.
Well, they started singing in the stands, celebrating, and this is almost like a victory lap for him now, because there's no danger of anybody catching him. He's going so well, so strong, as Paula was saying, and goodness me, he must be enjoying these moments. Joshua Cheptegei, just 20 years of age, great performance at the Olympic Games last year. The only thing that will be a slight disappointment to him is that he might have dreamt of becoming Uganda's first ever gold medalist in the World Cross Country Championships. Well, sadly for him, but not for his country, he's the second man, or will be the second man, because his junior teammate already taken the under 20 title. What a day for the host nation here. Moving serenely on, Cheptegei. No danger at all. There's so many big names behind him, so many stars of cross country. And to me, Paula, it was fast early pace, and then they picked it up, maintained it, pulled the field apart. We don't often see that happening, and to such an extent that I'm sure behind him, places are changing all over the place. But he won't care about that. He ripped the heart out of this race, and he's going to be rewarded with the title and the gold medal. A couple more hills to go, about another 800 meters of running, and it will be his.
Yeah, and he's raced this hard with a lot of knowledge of the course. It isn't one yet. Kamworo still looks strong. He certainly isn't fatiguing fast behind, but he just isn't able to raise his pace enough to be able to compete with the pace that Cheptegei is putting in at the front. And you have to think, Stephen Kiprotich, a lot further back somewhere in this race, we can't tell you how far back, will have been a huge inspiration to this guy growing up. And I'm sure that the likes of Cheptegei, Kiplimo will have been here and trained, as I've said, over and over on this course and worked out their best strategy. The Kenyans are very famous for working on their strategies to come away with world cross country victories. But the Ugandans have really worked hard and planned this, and it'd be good to see the team come through and be able to do something as well.
I'm getting worried for him. He's got to use these back markers if he's going to win this race, because Kamworo is charging now. And the crowd is celebrating. We've almost been celebrating on his behalf, but he looks very tired. And that knee lift is gone. His stride length is shortened. The arms are trying to work, and he's anxiously looking behind because Camworo is on the charge here, and there's still about 600 metres left. And he's nearly tripping up. This could end up really sadly for Cheptegei, who's led this race. I said he ripped the heart out of it, but has he, in so doing, destroyed his own chances? Camworo is reinvigorated. The defending champion is now only 2 seconds behind. Oh, dear me. Poor Cheptegei is completely gone.
It's like he's running through quicksand, and you can just see that's like a big whack in the stomach as Camworo runs past him. And it's a big boost for Camworo, but it must be breaking the heart of Chemetai there, who really needs to keep going to hang on to the silver medal now, because he will be coming under threat from the athletes behind.
Well, I said, Paula, it was so hard, wasn't it, after that big, to go so hard in the middle of the race. You've got to be really confident about maintaining that. And although Camworo did his best to go with it, he couldn't. He's just coming out the other end of it stronger. And sometimes when you give up a little bit and let the guy go and the guy keeps pushing on, yes, you can sort of maintain your pace a bit better. And then all of a sudden you realise that the guy in front, I don't think Camworo's picked it up that much. He's just maintained. What's happened is Cheptegei has completely fallen apart. Really sad. The flags were flying, they were cheering, they were dancing. We were handing him the gold medal because he looked so good. And then within, it was that hill at the kind of a third of the way into the last lap, suddenly there was nothing left. Suddenly all the energy had gone, suddenly all his confidence had gone, and with it the chance of the world title, the chance of joining his teammate as the world champion. So now it's going to be left to Geoffrey Camworo of Kenya, the man who in 2015 really stepped up. Oh, and he looks terrible. He really is going to need some help here. Poor Cheptegei is getting a little bit of a push from one of the lap runners, but there are going to be so many people passing him. I hope he makes it to the finish line. It was a brave effort, but it's going to end in sad failure for the Ugandan. Camworo waving, the crowd have gone silent, absolutely silent. A few of them applauding Camworo, but Cheptegei is in real trouble. It's so sad to see. I hope he's okay. So Geoffrey Camworo defends his title. He's run really strongly. When he maybe thought the race had gone, he kept going, he kept plugging away, and he's rewarded with another world title to add to the world half marathon title he won last year, and this title that he won 2 years ago, gold medal for Kenya. Barsaton is going to take the silver medal. He stayed strong as well, and then there was lots of changes behind in terms of the positions, and it's going to be Hadis who comes in to be the first of the Ethiopians, and then we'll start counting for the team. But all eyes and all hope and all fingers crossed for Cheptegei that he can make it to the finish line. A heroic performance from Camworo in the front, but it will be an equally heroic achievement if Cheptegei can get to the finish line. Really worried for him now, as you see the other runners coming in, and of course the Kenyans will be celebrating. Toritich, the first of the Ugandan athletes, he will have passed his teammate on the way in. Jaylan, the former world champion there, Komon there, and still Cheptegei is still waiting to come, and I hope that they're ready for him, and I hope that the medics are ready.
Yeah, I haven't ever seen an athlete come apart that badly in a cross-country race. I mean, in the marathon you see things like that happen, but he's really, really in difficulty there, and I do hope that somebody's there at the finish for him.
Joshua Cheptegei run himself into the ground in trying to win the gold medal for his country and for his team in front of his home crowd. What an effort from him, and he is going to make it to the finish line. So sad. I hope he gets some attention straight away. Well, you have to hand it to Kamworo, a good performance from him, and you know he'll be feted in Kenya as the man who has defended his title in grand style. But I think this race will be remembered for the brave, but in the end forlorn effort of Cheptegei. As Paula was saying, never really seen anybody struggle so much in the latter stages of a cross-country race of only 10k. I say only 10k, but it was the way in which he attacked the race in the second third and really took it to everybody else and looked as though he'd done enough to win it. He just had to keep going but was unable to do so.
You have to say at the finish there, it's a little bit chaotic scenes as well. A lot of people milling around that probably shouldn't really be in that finish area. A lot of athletes finishing and needing somewhere to at least lean against something or to move to the sides and not able to find the space to do that. And we hope that in the middle of all of that, somebody is looking after Cheptegei and making sure that he's okay. And I think Geoffrey Kamworo will come away from today very satisfied with a World Cross victory again, but also a little bit surprised because maybe in the middle of that race, yes, you have to keep hoping that you're going to be able to get back and get back on terms, but he wouldn't have expected Cheptegei to fall apart quite like that over the closing stages. I think Ethiopia came out of that with the team victory, but we don't have any data or stats to go on for that. I think they did just finish ahead of Kenya in the team race.
Well, we will tidy all of that up. Don't forget, if you're watching us or you've been watching us on the red button, you can see the highlights and hopefully the full results in our program on BBC Two at 5 o'clock. And I really do apologize again for the inability for us to give you the full results in all of the races. That is down to the technology, which hopefully most of the time seems to work okay, but sadly today for whatever reason has not been at its best, even though we had some great racing. And we've tried to certainly give you some unofficial results in terms of team races, but that will all get tidied up. And as I said, if you tune into the highlights program on BBC Two, then those details by then hopefully will be available. Be pretty close in the team race, I think, there, because Kenya were obviously 1 and 2 and then had 2-3 others a little further down, but like Paula said, it looked as though there were 4 Ethiopians across the line before the 4th of the Kenyans. Well, the other thing we all hope for as well is that Cheptegei is okay. I'm sure that we'll get some news on that as well. Well, that might be deemed as it's odd to say it's a bit of a surprise that Kamworo wins, because you know he's such a great athlete, but that's his best run obviously since the summer. You know, Rio was a massive disappointment, and as you said, he had all of those problems, had the rest afterwards. So just an indication that 2017 could be a better year for Kamworo, particularly when he gets up back on the track. At least we're expecting him to get back on the track, and this may have given him the confidence to do that. Apart from beating the rest of his teammates, then he's beaten the best of the world in terms of cross country. Well, the interviews have already started for Geoffrey Kamworo, and he'll probably be trying to find out how his training partner Stephen Kiprotich did, representing Uganda. It's funny because I think it's not funny at all, but Cheptegei at one point, apart from leading his team, leading himself, it looked as though the team may well be in with a chance, but then with because it's great. It's almost like you only need three counters because you have someone who wins it. That's 1 point. So sadly, not only losing out in terms of his performance individually, they will have lost out in terms of a team opportunity. And again, I do apologise for our inability to give you full results. I can tell you that so far all that's appearing is the top two. And we're trying to hope that we might get an official result of the top 10 coming up shortly. But if not, we'll be leaving you shortly on the red button. As I said, just to remind you again, highlights later on BBC Two. Just this while we're waiting, Paula, for results. I mean, if you look at someone like Camworo, there's we've got World Championships coming up in the summer. There's talk about him moving, up to the marathon properly because of his half marathon prevalence, etc. I mean, where do you think he sits in his career at the moment?
I think he has to decide for himself where he's most comfortable. I mean, I'm a big believer. People always ask, when did you want to move up to the marathon? When you really feel like you are ready to attack the marathon, because a marathon is a special animal. It's something you really have to respect but not be afraid of. And I think if you're still a little bit afraid in your head, a little bit more comfortable on the track, on the cross country, then stick with that until you're ready to really attack it, and to attack it like you're going to be able to control the marathon.
Well, he may well be patient enough to wait until Mo Farah retires on the track in London, over 10,000 metres. And, the next World Championships on the track, of course, are in Doha in 2019. But he is the champion here today. He's defended his title supremely well, given the fact that Cheptegei, his brave effort, ended up in extreme fatigue. But it's been a great day of racing, some new names to look out for, as well as some established stars doing well, some new events as well, with the mixed relay adding to the World Cross Country Championships. Paul and I have enjoyed the last 4 hours. I hope you've enjoyed all the coverage. I do apologize again for the lack of results, but as I said, you can see all of the highlights on BBC Two at 5 o'clock. But from Paula and I, it's goodbye.